Good evening and welcome to our Spring Candidates Forum at A.T. Still University, presented by the Kirksville Chamber of Commerce's Governmental Affairs Committee. This forum is available on Facebook Live and the City of Kirksville's YouTube channel. The forum will also be broadcast on Cable One's local channel 56 at noon and 7 p.m. March 30th, noon and 7 p.m. March 31st, and 7 p.m. and 9 p.m. April 1st. Before we get to the forum, we have two informational presentations on April 2nd ballot questions. First, we will welcome to the podium, Brad Ray.
Thank you. I'm Brad Ray. I'm the fire chief for the Novender Northern Volunteer Fire Department in rural Adair County. We've got a ballot initiative on the April 2nd ballot to create a fire protection district for rural Adair County. It is a proposed for a 30% per hundred of assessed value tax, so it'll be a tax-funded fire protection district. Still volunteer, but tax-funded. Additional revenue that we'll receive from this will go towards assisting us in reducing our response time to calls throughout Adair County, doing that by providing a stipend to volunteers in rural Adair County. The current associations that are in the Adair County are both membership associations that are funded by voluntarily paying memberships per year. Currently have about a 60% collection of those, and it's not a completely fair system now. The guy that has a house in 100 by 100 yard could possibly pay the same amount as the guy that has 500 acres and $1 million house. So the tax funding of this would make it a lot more fair for all of rural Adair County residents instead of just membership based. It's also, you know, 2019. We don't believe that you should have to be a member of an association to receive the same service that everybody expects throughout the nation of fire, police, EMS. And currently that is the way in rural Adair County that it is. So it is for a 30 cent per assessed value of personal and real property, fire protection district that's gonna be on the ballot April 2nd. Thank you.
Thank you. Now please welcome Don Crosby.
Thank you. I'm here to talk about 911. How many people have called 911 with emergency before? You know, 3 years ago I slipped on the ice and broke my ankle. And it's 5 a.m. on a Saturday, and it surely was reassuring to be able to pull out my old trusty Motorola Razor and dial 911 and to hear 911 was the location emergency and to know that help was coming. So that's what we're up here to talk about, help coming. I gotta tell you that the most important slide I have for you is this one right here. When we first started in 2001, I gotta tell you, great thing that we did. In 2001, we got together with the city, the county, the fire, the Amos District, and Truman State, and we said, what can we do to save the taxpayer money and increase efficiency? We did this great thing about combining all these 24-hour resources that were all over the place and combined them into one, got a much better system for it. But it cost $275,000 back then, and we got $60,000 worth of revenue from phone tax for people in Adair County, rural Adair County. Today, the cost increased to $750,000. Why is that? This thing. It costs lots of money to keep up with these things and to have the technology that says, if Don calls in the middle of that parking lot, he can't say a word, but they know exactly where I'm at. Within a couple meters, they know where I'm at, they know how to get help to me. That costs money. Personnel costs money, insurance costs money, but prices are crazy increasing. What we're asking to do is that we want to talk about having a, we want to talk about having adding a dollar to your phone bill, your cell phone bill, your home phone bill. Missouri, the last state in the union, that allows the increased cost to cell phone to be added to your cell phone bills. Last state. We want to get up with the technology and say, hey, we have a chance to increase our technology to better our system and cost a dollar. So please consider voting yes for this.
Thank you. We will now welcome our candidates to the table. The candidates you hear from tonight will appear on the April 2nd municipal election ballot. Thanks to each of them for their willingness to serve. I'm Jason Hunsiger from the Kirksville Daily Express. A panel including myself, Kirksville Tourism Director Debbie Mountain, and Kirksville Chamber of Commerce Executive Director Sandra Williams met previously to determine the format and questions for this evening's event. I will serve as moderator and reserve the right to ask follow-up questions and seek clarification from candidates if necessary. Each candidate will be given 2 minutes to make an opening statement. During the question and answer portion, each candidate will have 2 minutes to offer a response. There will be no closing statements. Debbie Mountain will be running the timer, the lights from which will be visible. A yellow light will signal 15 seconds remain for your response. A flashing red light indicates time has expired. I do welcome all of you when the flashing red light comes on. You're welcome to finish your thoughts. You don't need to stop in the middle of a sentence and walk away. It'll be okay. But wrap it up quickly. Candidates must remain in their assigned locations or at the podium at all times during the forum. Candidates may not interrupt one another or ask questions of each other. Candidates must refrain from personal attacks or charges. There are 3 seats up for election on April 2nd. The 2 candidates with the highest vote totals will win 3-year terms. The 3rd highest vote getter will win a 1-year term. Your candidates, in the order they appear on the ballot, are Jordan Weichelt, Kevin Alm, Zach Burden, Chuck Long, Stephen Reeser, Donald Smith, Daniel Joyner, and Jessica Parks. How about a round of applause for the candidates? We did a very fancy random drawing of names before the event began to determine the order of speaking for each round. It's now time for opening statements. Now I'll invite Jordan Weichelt to the podium.
Well, good evening. Thank you for being here. Thank you for everyone watching online and everyone that will be watching later at a later time. It is important to be an informed voter. Let me tell you, by voting for me, Jordan Weichel would be a good vote on April 2nd. I graduated from Kirksville High School. I worked at the South McDonald's for 8 years. I work here now at AT Still University, and I'm a local boy. I am determined on the first day that anyone could file for city council, I sat on the front steps of City Hall in December, below 30 degree temperatures for over an hour, waiting for the doors to open to be the first one to file. I'm young, I'm energetic, I'm optimistic, and I'm running to represent you. I am determined to fix our roads, our sidewalks, and add more trails to our community. I've been talking to different people throughout the community, and overwhelmingly, the number one issue that people have voiced to me has been the roads. No matter where I go, it's been consistent, and it's been vocal, and it's been clear. I don't own any businesses. I'm not running as a political party. I'm running to represent you. You deserve better. Your tax dollars deserve better, and our community deserves better. A vote for Jordan Weichel is a vote for your roads. I thank my family for being here, and my friends, my coworkers, and my campaign team. I thank God for the opportunity to run. Thank you.
Kevin Ohm.
I've been in Kirksville for 44 years, and I moved from Richmond Racer from Kewaunee, Illinois. I was born and raised there, and I'm a little shaky right now, but that's all. But the thing, you all know, you know my life is already, most of you already know my life, how it is and things. But I can tell, let me slow down here. There are so many things I'd like to see the city change. I'm with someone change different ways. Apart from the bus, also I'd like to see the city government. What I've heard, and I understood what the people want. They want to see a whole new city government take place. But I don't want to eliminate some of the issues. I'd like for one. They want to go back to I'm a little nervous right now. But they want to, the people want to say, a mayor and council type of city government instead of a council manager. They want to put things back like it was 100 years ago. We're 2019, we're just at the beginning of the Great Depression, like it was 100 years ago. We need to do something about it, and I can say more, but I think I'm running out of time.
Zach Burden.
Really great to be with everyone tonight, and I just want to say how honored I am to be here as a candidate for the Kirksville City Council. It means a lot to me. You know, as I've been walking around this community and talking with people in the last several months about my campaign, I focus less on specific things that I want to see accomplished during my time on the council, and more about how I plan to work as a city council member, and I want to share just a few of those with you this evening. The first is that I want to be a council member who is always listening to this community. I've been on the council for 6 months in an appointed capacity. There's not been a single person who's come before the council that I haven't reached out to afterwards with a letter or a phone call or an email or in person to try to learn more about what their concern is, to try to gather more information and find out ways maybe that we could help. Sometimes we don't always agree, but more often than not, people are turning the needle, moving that in a direction for me so I can better understand and help them with the things that we've got going on. But that's only one half of the equation. The other half is that as a member of the council, it's my duty to make sure that I get out into the community and talk and have conversations, which is why part of my campaign is the idea of bringing my lawn chair to your neighborhood. I really want to have an opportunity to get around to as many neighborhoods that will have me as a council member and sit in driveways with people and talk about what's going on in our community to bring that discussion and listening to where we are throughout. The other things that I would say is that I'm always going to be someone who does my homework, who always comes to meetings prepared, fully researching things and with questions to ask, if only because I think they're the questions that you might want to ask if you were sitting in my seat. And then the last thing I'll say is that I want this to be an opportunity for us as a community to talk about what it really means to be a community. Is a city just about the idea of services that are owed to its citizens, or is living together in a city about a shared experience and the responsibilities we have to one another? If elected, I hope to be able to pursue those things on your behalf. Thank you very much.
Chuck Long.
Hello everybody, how is everybody tonight? I'm going to tell you right now, I don't have a suntan, this tie is choking me a little
perfect. Yeah. I think everybody knows me. I am a city councilman now for 3 years, been mayor for one. Been in Kirksville all my life, with the exception of a short stay in Kansas City as I was going to college, not in jail. That sounded like a little off there. But I'm not long-winded. I don't like to make big speeches, as everybody probably already knows. I'm short, sweet, to the point, but I'm on the council to help Kirksville and help the people. And that is the bottom line. There is no axes for me to grind. I have no hidden agendas. I'm here just for the people and just for the town. Thank you.
Steve Reeser.
Hi, everyone. Thank you for coming. My name is Steve Reeser. You know, I have moved here in Kirksville in 1972, you know, with my family. We owned and operated a local automobile dealership. And, you know, with that, I got a lot of experience, you know, working in, you know, with customer service, working with technology, you know, getting to know what it takes to be a part of Kirksville. One of the things that, you know, I wanted to do is to be able to look at, you know, some of the problems that we have and make, you know, that my desire to work with, you know, you and the other members of the city council on, you know, getting resolutions to large scale items that, you know, we're all facing. You know, to where you deserve a lot, you're paying taxes for a lot. As part of this, we have challenges that we're all currently facing. Some of it, you know, is because of the economic conditions of North Missouri. You know, if you look at 34% of our, you know, population is below the poverty line. How can we get jobs into Kirksville? You know, to where, you know, we want to get, you know, real jobs, you know, for real people. You know, when I'm looking at some of these other, you know, part of it is, you know, I look at, you know, the people of Kirksville. You know, a lot of them, you know, to where there are 17,000, you know, citizens in Kirksville. Roughly 2/3 of those are eligible to vote. Out of that, only half of the, you know, registered or the eligible registered voters actually are registered. And out of those 7,000 that are registered, only 1,200 people voted in the last municipal election. And why is this? It's because people are feeling that government doesn't listen to you. You know, they are looking at it as, you know, a way, you know, to where they're wanting somebody to address this and get it back to them. Thank you very much. I hope that, you know, get your vote on April 2nd.
Donald Smith.
People, it's handicapped. The older people don't get raises every year. Kevin was right. We need to get this city form of government out. They don't do nothing but fix one street a year. We fix one street. Oh, that's a miracle. We got to stop that crap. Let's do it for the people. Let's get every road fixed. Let's try to be welcome people that we're supposed to and not be outrageous about it. Don't have overpay something that you shouldn't. My brother used to live in Illinois. My water bill was higher than his, and he had trash pickup and the whole thing. There's people on Social Security. Maybe they can get a raise, maybe they don't. They gotta live. What, do you wanna pay the water bill? Well, if you don't pay that water bill, you're gonna be condemned. You're either one way or the other. I'm running for the people. It's got to have some way of relief. Let's go back to that old way. Kevin was right. We don't need this city form of government because It's breaking us. Thank you.
Daniel Joyner.
Hello, Kirksville. My name is Daniel Joyner. A little bit about me. I grew up here since I was 8 years old. My dad was a local eye doctor. Graduated from Kirksville High School in 2004. Like Chuck, short and sweet. Don't have too much to say as far as opening statements. I think there needs to be new direction. I don't want to say a whole new government. I don't feel like there's anything wrong with the status quo, but I hope to bring a little new direction if elected. That said, this isn't my deal. Public speaking is not at the top of my short list. So if you're looking for kissing babies and photo opportunities, not me. I'm a behind-the-scenes kind of guy. I can promise I'll be in and out of city directors' offices. Importantly, because I feel like as council members, we need to get out and to speak to these people. I don't think that we should sit on our high horse and expect them to come to us with their problems and concerns. Like I said, I think there's a disconnect between the residents and the council members. I'd like to get out and meet more of you if I could. I was late to the game. Some of you may or may not know that I work for the state of Missouri at the Juvenile Justice Center, and I needed to make sure there was no conflict of interest before I ran for city council. Didn't want to spend hundreds, if not thousands of dollars, only to find out that I wasn't eligible. So I spoke with not only the state's attorney general, but the Missouri Ethics Commission, and they cleared me to go. That said, I hope I have your vote come April 2nd. Thank you.
Jessica Parks.
Hopefully you can see me over the podium. My name is Jessica Parks. I'm currently the executive director and founder of Take Root Cafe, so you may have seen me there. My background is in anthropology, human rights, and education. So I am not originally from Kirksville, but me and my husband and son moved here in 2014. And we instantly fell in love with Kirksville. I really love the kind of the country feel, but also being able to live in a city. So I fell in love with the place. We opened up Take Root Cafe. I'm also very active in the community. I'm part of the Merchants Committee for the Chamber of Commerce, the Kirksville Downtown Improvement Committee. I volunteer at the primary school, so I love to get involved in my community, and I would do the same thing if elected on council. So I think, like a lot of the other candidates have said, we need an active council. We need representatives for the people, really listening and talking to the citizens of Kirksville. So one of the things I really believe in and I feel passionate about is that everyone in our city should have access to healthy food, clean water, and safe housing. So I see a lot of potential for positive growth, but I don't think that it can happen alone. And so that's one of the things that I really want to see is not just let's look at the city staff or just look at the city council to answer our problems, that we really need to come together as a community and be able to work collaboratively and work together for to really see big community-wide positive changes in our town. So I'm really excited, and I would love to have your vote on April 2nd. Thank you so much.
Okay, our first question tonight. The condition of city streets is always a hot topic amongst the public and many of the candidates seeking a seat on the city council. The city has recently made investments, including the purchase of an asphalt plant. What is your opinion on the current effort toward maintaining and improving city streets? And if you believe more must be done, what are your suggestions and how would those additions be funded? Our first candidate to answer this question, Jessica Parks.
So, this is a very hot topic, and as I've been talking with people over the last few months, the roads are the issue that just keeps coming up, and we've had a really rough winter, and so driving over those potholes over and over again is not enjoyable. In terms of the asphalt plant specifically and how road improvements would be funded, I'm going to be honest with you, I am not an expert on road construction. I am not an expert in terms of city finances, but one of the things that you can count on me doing is if this is a concern, and it is, of our citizens, then I will do as much research and homework. It's one of my things. I can go deep into a subject and find out as much as possible as I can about a topic. And so this is definitely something that I would look into. I've talked to a lot of people, and there are a lot of differing opinions about what to do about our roads. I don't think the answer is just patching up potholes. I know that's an immediate band-aid solution, and we still need to do that so people can drive to work right now. But I do think it's important to put in quality roads. After talking with Glenn about the roads, and for example, like Illinois, I know a lot of people were frustrated that maybe too much money was spent on that road, but I think we have had years of not putting enough quality roads in Kirksville, and so that's why they're deteriorating so fast. And so it's unfortunate, but maybe we're gonna have to spend a little bit more to have quality roads that are gonna last over time. So I don't know exactly how that would be funded right now, but I can guarantee you that I will look into it and I will do as much research as needed into this subject as I can if elected. Thank you.
Jordan Whitehouse.
So what has the city done to address our roads in the last few years? I will be honest, the city has done more than I thought they have. This is what the city has done. They did a case study on every single road, and they found out the condition of every single road. They purchased an asphalt plant, and to cut more costs, instead of contracting projects, street projects, they use their own men, and they did that, for example, on Illinois Street. So for example, Illinois Street, the estimated cost was $2.5 million, but since it was not contracted out, they only spent $750,000, so they saved a lot of money. I commend the city for doing that. But people want to see results, and it's been very vocal that people aren't satisfied with the roads, so what do I suggest? Well, first, let's look at the numbers. The case study suggested that the minimum street budget per year should be $2.4 million. And we're currently spending $2.1 million. And the budget for 2020 is only $1.8 million. The preferred road budget, according to the case study, which was an independent group, they said it should be $3.1 million. And a manageable network would be $4 million annually. Again, that's that. Considering contracting work out. So what do these numbers mean to me? We're not spending enough on our roads, and it's a problem. So what's the solution? Well, if I was elected to city council, I promise you that since this has been my issue on my campaign, that I would look at our current budget. Where do we have wasteful spending? Where is our wasteful government spending? Can we find wasteful spending and use it to our roads? Two, I would look to allocate more roads. And three, if I was on a council and I didn't find a solution just by looking at the budget, I would give it to the voters and put on the ballot a sales tax. And I would let the voters decide if they would do that to fix the roads. Thank you.
Kevin Hall.
Thank you.
part, I would like to see our streets get repaired. For last year, I've seen the city council has worked on the city square on the streets and stuff. Well, you wonder why the streets and not other streets are not being repaired first, besides working on around the square. But I know the curbing and all this is going on. But for years, we always had street problems. But a lot of the streets have been repaired, and some of them are just being patched up. But what happens to one street? If you guys want to see it, it's on between Decker and Missouri Street, which is north boundary, which is completely undrivable right now. So I'd rather see our streets be safe and repaired, not just being patched up. And also, I'd like to see additional streets come in. I know there's other areas that need to be these additional streets to ease the flow of the traffic around town. But it'd be nice to get something done before somebody gets hurt. And I've already seen over the years also worked with Bud's auto body. I've seen quite a few vehicles been heavily damaged by potholes and more. And also the monster curbs around, we got them sitting around the center town area. It's open. Once you hit them, you're out of luck. Thank you.
Zach Berlin.
You know, one of the things that I love most about Kirksville is this idea that when there's a problem, we can come up with a solution together on it. When I think about when we looked at our transportation needs coming up from Macon, and when we looked about creating a route around town, that was us coming together as a community and saying that this is important to us, and we want to make that a financial priority. I think we've got some really great things going with where we're headed on our street development and turning that into a system we can be proud of. I understand it's going to take some time. And I understand that it could be more. And if that's something that folks are willing to look at and to pay for, that's a discussion I think we could have as a community. But I also like where we're headed currently with some things. With the ability to do some roads in-house and continuing to work with outside contractors, the city will be able to tackle more miles of roads this year than it ever has in the past. And with more and more years of that in progression, we're going to be able to see some turnaround in the condition of our roads. But it does take time, and I know that's a frustrating concept, especially after a hard winter when you hit potholes, and thinking that time is something that we can have a luxury on there. But I also look back to that innovating spirit that Kirksville community has on that. This community agreed to continue the sales tax that was in place to handle the expansion of four lane and our alternate route around Kirksville, to dedicate money from that towards our road system, to continue to make improvements from that. We're going to start to see some really great results coming from that. But if folks would like to see more, I think that's a discussion as a community that we can have in making sure the financial resources are there in order to make it happen. In the meantime, if you've got concerns, do what I do too. Just continue to call those in. We have a wonderful streets department who continues to look at things. Pothole replacement gets us through in the short term. And then looking at long-term solutions, I think we can come up with some things together that will get us there. I appreciate it. Thank you very much.
Chuck Long.
Well, the great thing about going behind Zach, there's absolutely nothing else to say. So I'm going to say something towards city staff. They've done a great job on it. They put themselves out there. They did a great job. They had to go clear down to the base and start all over on that street. They ended up getting the job done quicker than the contractors had bid that job to get done. So I do know the streets are in terrible shape. Man, I'm the first one to tell you. 3/4-ton truck, I got to go home and tighten my teeth up every night. But please just be patient with us. We have a learning curve. We have a new asphalt plant. We have guys that are learning how to do all these things. So it's just going to take us a little bit of time. I know it seems like a little too late, but we will get caught up, I promise. Thank you.
Stephen Reeser.
Buick. I drive on the Kirksville streets, you know, and I hit about every other pothole and try and swerve and hope the police aren't, you know, wondering why I'm swerving going down the road. But, you know, this Department of Public Works, they're working hard. You know, I've listened to, you know, the director, you know, talk about the, you know, things that he's going to do. Kirksville is going to do more streets than they've ever done before. You know, it's going to take a joint effort between city and, you know, basically our contractors, you know, that have done it before. It's going to take time. It's going to take money. Where is this money going to come from? It's going to basically come from one of two ways. One, we're going to have to look at, you know, money that is reallocated, you know, from other projects, or, you know, we're going to probably have to look at going to you and saying these are taxes that would go towards those, you know, streets. Basically, you know, it comes to there, you know, I think you're going to see a lot of good things coming out of the streets, you know, this year. It's just going to take time. It's been a hard winter. You go, I was just down in St. Louis. They're facing the same thing. Every city in Missouri is facing this. So please, you know, bear, you know, with us a little bit. You know, when I'm voted into, you know, the city council, you know, call me, send me an email. That's what I'm here for, is going to help you to be able to go ahead and talk to Glenn Ballou and then bend his ear for you as well. I'm sure he'd like to hear that. Thank you.
Some of these roads that need to be worked on ain't just blacktop. They're concrete. They bought the land where the concrete roads are. They're supposed to take care of them. They did not. They're cracked. They're tearing tires up. And I see a little patch job as it go in. Goes down to about the end of the road, and that's it. The other holes, we got them good. I hit them every night. I don't think they're doing that. I think they're just doing what they're told to do. And you go so far, and that's it. That's just like last year. We got one road fixed. One. How many roads do we have? I think we got more than one. And you can't just fix it with just a patch job. Some of these roads in town are concrete. It ain't blacktop. So why did they buy that big machine for it? When they said they was going to close it down for a year. I mean, why'd they buy it for if they're going to do something like that? Don't sound like they're going to do much on work. Get somebody in there that's going to do something. And listen to the people. I'm Don Smith. Thank you.
Daniel Joyner.
Yes, this is a very hot topic. I had the pleasure of meeting with Glenn Ballou. He is in attendance tonight. Glenn, if you want to stand up and recognize yourself. He is an extraordinary individual. We talked at length. I got 2 minutes to go through 5 pages of stuff that we talked about. I was surprised when he told me I was the first candidate to come speak with him. I was one of the last to declare candidacy, and he said, yeah, you're the first guy in the door. I was surprised by that, but the important part is, Glenn said he's been at Public Works for, what, 5 years, I think he said? And there was no road construction plan in place when he got there. He's completely overhauled what they're doing now. Shout out to the Public Works crew. because I agree, it was a terrible winter. It was long and it just kept right on rolling. And these are the same individuals that go plow our streets, clear the snow. And the second spring shows up, we bash them because the roads are bad. They're the same folks. We've got one crew, and they have 12 different hats that they have to wear. Furthermore, when talking with Glenn, the streets don't generate revenue. That's a fact. I hope you all know that. If not, let me give you some insight. We can't tax the streets because they won't pay us back. We have to get taxed from somewhere. My big overwhelming plan, if sales tax is needed, I want it like a booster shot to step down over time. I'd like to see 1 cent the first year, a half cent the next, and then by the third year, we're done to terminate a sales tax so that we can use that money as needed, bolster the revenue, and then be finished with it. Thank you.
Next question. The city is currently in the midst of overhauling its municipal code. What is your opinion of the process so far, and what areas of the code, in your opinion, should receive the most attention? Our first candidate to answer this question is Daniel Joyner.
Oh dear. Okay, this is gonna be real short and sweet because I was focused on the streets. Municipal code. In all honesty, I would like to defer to the other candidates. I haven't spent much time dealing with this. It's not my forte. I believe people are in place on the council that do a good job with the municipal code. As far as I'm concerned, I think the overhaul is necessary and a good thing. Once it gets in place, I believe it'll be for the best. Thanks.
Jessica Martins.
Thank you. So I did attend all of the municipal code meetings that the city held a few weeks ago to just try to gain as much knowledge as I could about our city code. Sometimes I do read it at night when I'm just sitting at home and things. I like to know what are the things that are happening, you know, what are the code that governs, you know, our city and what goes on there. So I really appreciated that the city was putting these community meetings on to have citizen input. I really liked the style of that. If you weren't there, they had different nights for different parts of the code over the course of four nights where you could come read the code, see the proposed changes, and then give input. My favorite part was actually having the city staff there. That's where I got to talk to a lot of the staff, like Glenn and Rodney and a lot of the people in different departments of the city to hear specifically about what's going on in those different areas. The areas of the code that should receive the most attention was part of our question, and I don't necessarily feel strongly about any one area of the code, but I do feel strongly that we should continue to allow for citizen input. So I think this was a great first step, and having, I don't know whether it be every 5 years or every couple years where there is a revision, I know it's a lot of work, I'm looking at Chait and I know how much work he's put into these revisions in the codes department, but to have just to make sure that the codes meet you know, the will of the people, that this is what our city wants, and that we're also changing with the times. One example I can give is I was really excited to see when the code was changed to reflect to allow more backyard chickens, because that was an area that a lot of citizens were wanting to see. Also sidewalks and more bike paths and things like that. So I'm being cut off, but those are areas that I would like to see more attention to. Thank you.
Jordan Weichelt.
think the city's done a good job at communicating to the public the process. I received a text message that they're going to be opening all week for the codes. I received an email. I was on my Facebook news feed. I think the city has done a really good job at communicating to the public what's going on. I was there as well. I was interested in looking at two different types of codes, one that dealt with the parks, another one that dealt with the roads and our infrastructure. No complaints on my end. I have been to city council meetings where people will complain about certain codes or regulations, but I thought the process was thorough, and for me personally, I looked at the parks codes and the roads and infrastructure. So those are ones that I thought should have most attention. Thank you.
Kevin Holm.
About cannabis and coming to Kirksville, but I know cannabis has been around for many years.
The question is regarding the municipal code.
Oh, municipal code.
Yes.
I thought we talked about number two.
There apparently was a little mix up with the sheets that you were given. The questions aren't necessarily in order in the sheets.
Okay. Sorry. Thank you. But about municipal code, I think we need I know there's a lot of need. The municipal code needs to do a lot of improvement, and I've seen a lot of people get hurt in certain ways. And I've seen ways that the municipal code has been going around in court punishing certain people and stuff. But I'm just one of them also. But who needs to go to jail for something that didn't do anything wrong? But it only makes sense when I'm talking. But I like to see an improvement of the municipal code. And to find out better strategies to work things out for other people, for you all. If somebody gets confused to court or settled in or out of court, there's so much I can say, but right now I'm just like a short amount of time. But if I can speak freely to you individually, I can express a lot better, but I can talk on a microphone, it's a little bit different. Thank you.
Zach Burden.
The current process with looking at our city codes really started as a reorganization and updating project to make sure that our codes were reflecting what it is that needed to be happening in our community. But what that became, and what I'm really excited about the city doing, is a conversation about where are the codes and what else needs updating and what do people think about those. Because really when we think about codes, we're talking about our agreement about living together in this community. And so this has been a great opportunity to get that started. And it's far from done. This is going to take months through this recodification process to look at, which means months of conversation and talking about where we want to go forward with this, for new ideas to come through, for us to examine where we're working through particular issues, and for an opportunity for minds to change, mine included. We've continued to work through things, and I've noticed in talking with people how I sure felt one way to begin with, but the more you talk with citizens on some things, you may begin to have a different sense on where things are headed with it. And I think that's an important part that we all keep in mind as we look at changing up our codes, that we're willing to accept possible change and where that might take us. I think the most exciting part of this is a legacy, that we don't have to wait for a recodification process for us to examine codes and how those impact our lives. With us talking about this more, with a community that's more engaged in it, we can look at codes at any time. You can work with a council member, work with city staff, and bring proposals and changes so that we can continue to be fluid in how we adapt that agreement that we have of living together, that we don't have to wait for a long-term process to make that happen. So Specifically for me, I'm excited that we're looking at parts around zoning and regulations that come with that, and making sure that's fairly applied throughout our entire community, so that people know and understand where they live, the expectations that come with that, and the expectation that you should be able to have as somebody who lives in that community, and how you might go about getting things taken care of if they don't meet those expectations. So I'm very excited about this, and I hope this leads to a lot more discussion about where we can go with our city codes. Thank you.
Chuck Long.
And again, following Zach, there's really not much to say. But recodification is absolutely not a fun thing to do. You can ask any city staffer that's in here right now. They've been many long days and nights trying to figure out what's going on with the codes and the proposed changes that are put out there. But at the end of the day, it all needs to be right for the citizens and right for the community. Both, not just one-sided. So if anybody has any input, obviously, give us a call. Let us know what you're thinking on any of the changes so we know what direction to go in. Thank you.
Stephen Reeser.
First off, I'd like to congratulate the staff for the job that they've done on revamping the codes. The codes needed to be revamped because there were contradictions, there were duplication. Before, a lot of the codes that Kirksville had were not in the same compliance or in the same language as the state. So we would sit there and have different ways to interpret that. Also, it took time because you would have to update one section and then you would have to go completely over to a different area to update this. They're establishing modern methods to set these standards by setting tables. One entry, you can update the code. These codes are also to where they're reflecting modern times. Things change. Codes that were built, made back in the 70s aren't always applicable of today. So why don't we look at these on a periodic basis? And that's what's happening today. Thank you.
Yeah, you could. You had to tie your horseless buggy up to out here so they won't get away. I don't know much about that, but if you run for city council, you can change your code so you can have your own way. I mean, I've seen it done before. It sounds like a crooked council to me, but go for it.
Okay. Our next question. The city council on Monday approved zoning language for medical marijuana dispensaries, manufacturing facilities, and other related businesses to locate in Kirksville. What is your opinion on the stipulations approved by the council? Would you seek to make any changes? And what, if anything, do you believe the city should do to attract these businesses? Our first person to answer this question, Zach Burton.
Well, you want to talk about the Wild West when it comes to new law and things for us to take a look at in our community, in our institutions within our community, within our whole state. We've got some new constitutional guidelines that come in, but there's a lot that's still undetermined. And what I'm really appreciative of the ordinance changes that we've passed on that is that we're trying to make some good steps in working through a situation that is going to be unfamiliar to everyone. I think we've got a measured approach that's been modeled after approaches that other cities have taken a look at, that professional organizations have recommended, so that we can have some rules in place that allow for the will of the voters to happen, but also make sure to protect our community in ways that we feel are important. I heard a speaker talk about where we're headed, and I asked a question. I said, when was the last time something was perhaps so large but ill-defined and was waiting to be decided over a series of court cases? And the answer he gave was prohibition. But it's really been that long since we've looked at something so large of an issue of law that is going to require some flexibility, direction, and some patience in moving forward with it. And that's scary. But what I think is not scary is the information that was brought together in formulating the ordinance that was passed that seeks to welcome the businesses in, to make it a welcoming place, to have the revenue that comes associated with that, that works for the medical needs that people have, but at the same time safeguards our community and keeps us the place that we would like for it to continue to be. So it's a balanced approach, it's a nuanced approach. I think it's the right direction. That's why I voted for it at the council meeting. So thank you very much.
It is a new thing, and it does take an open mind to accept it into our city. But knowing people personally who do suffer from chronic pain and seizures and other things, it's going to be a godsend for them to be able to have that locally and something that they can take care of right here at home. So I did vote yes for it because I think to welcome any new business in town is a good thing, always. New tax dollars, bigger tax dollars. So maybe we can get the streets fixed faster. So thank you.
Good job right here.
37 states have passed laws about marijuana recreational. You know, we've got a lot of past, you know, history from what they have, you know, put into law to go ahead and develop Kirksville. You're going through. There's other states that are looking at Kirksville. How do we handle medical marijuana? How are we going to address, you know, the regulations to bring this into our rules and into our everyday life? You know, part of it is you're looking at different parts of this. It's not just a magic medical marijuana. You know, you've got the retail, you've got, you know, the testing, you've got the growing. And the city council, you know, and the planning and zoning looked at each parts of this to really control it, to regulate it, and to make it safe for Kirksville. There's a lot of, you know, history, you know, through this to where helping the people that need to be helped. You know, hopefully we can go ahead, we can get this in to make it right, you know, for the city of Kirksville. We can help the people that need this in the city of Kirksville, and then we can go ahead and with the tax revenue that is going to generate, like, you know, Chuck said, like Zach said, this is going to help build those streets as well, revenue. Thank you.
Donald Smith.
Along with the help of the handicap too, it's good, but there's going to be people out there that's going to abuse it too. Sheriff's going to have his hands full. He's going to have a lot to do with this because there's people like drugs and they're not going to do it legally. So he's going to have his hands full all the time. I don't know how he's going to catch all of them, but I like to see the people helped, no matter what. Medical-wise, it helps the handicapped. Real. I know a few. I like that. Thank you.
Daniel Joyner.
Okay, another hot topic, marijuana dispensaries. Right, so the question states, first of all, we all got a list of questions. Questions got flipped. Some of us got caught off guard. I think that's part of being a councilman. You just kind of have to go with it. So forgive me if some of our answers last question were short and sweet, but kind of took us by surprise. Speaking of medical marijuana, It's polarizing, pretty much always has been polarizing. I think specific to the question, changes, what can we do to attract business? I think specifically the dispensaries should be downtown. I think if we could keep them as close to law enforcement officials, I think that's for the best. Furthermore, my background is not specifically law enforcement, but like I said, I work for the state, secure detention for juvenile justice. That said, I think the manufacturing facilities, I'd like to see them secure, if not overly secure, so that everything stays above the table. I think it would be an excellent source of revenue. I think we as Kirksvillians could be trendsetters. We could remain a hub, remain a hub in the community to attract people in, so that we're not having to just tax our specific residents. I'd like to see manufacturing sites, I'd like to see small square footage. I'd like to see incentives towards small business, maybe incentives towards residents, citizens, starting their own, because I don't want to see a big company come in and have us, you know, big box retailer producing everything that could produce jobs on a number of scales for local residents. Thank you.
Jessica Parks.
Thank you. Yes. So while it is sometimes a divisive issue, I do think it is important to recognize, like what a few other candidates talked about, that it is an important piece for people who are in pain, who are sick, to have access to medical marijuana. Specifically on the measures that the council approved yesterday, I was at that meeting and they did talk about the kind of three different areas, so dispensaries, manufacturing, and then also cultivation. And I thought it was really important, and I liked how they looked at those individually. So manufacturing and cultivation, they did, they are specific zones in the city, can only be for those types of facilities. And then they also had, I think, a 300-foot buffer from like schools, churches, and daycares, which I thought was an important piece to make sure, again, making sure we're keeping people safe and those facilities safe as well. In terms of dispensaries, they're treating them like pharmacies, and so those can be in retail spaces. There's not a buffer in terms of that. So I thought that was really thoughtful, and I liked how the city is trying to reflect the state law, while it's still a little bit confusing right now, but that they did a good job of looking at that issue thoughtfully.
Jordan Whitehead.
I'm not an expert at medical marijuana. I did have a good friend last fall encouraged me to vote to pass the law, and I did because they have cancer and they said that it would help them. And so it does help people, and I'm very appreciative of that. I am skeptical of the whole process though. We have a huge problem with meth here in Adair County, and like was said earlier, people could abuse it, so I am skeptical. Someone this morning came to my office actually and started talking to me about the KTVO article that was mentioned. I think it should be regulated smart. I think we need to be really careful and it needs to be safe. Again, I'm not an expert, but I do have a quote. It says that the Planning and Zoning Commission voted unanimously to recommend to the council that medical marijuana dispensaries be allowed to locate within commercial districts without restrictions on their proximity to elementary and secondary schools, daycares, churches, or other buildings regularly used as a place of worship. So the one thing that I would change would be as far as the distance from where these can be located. I think there should be more than 300 feet between a facility and a daycare, or a facility and a church, or a facility and a school. Thank you.
Kevin Hall.
oppose the use of cannabis in every way. But I would like to see the Kirk School to change the strategy to using hemp instead of marijuana. There's a reason why I say that, because marijuana and hemp both have, they both look like the same, but have leaf patterns, but they are two different plants. But with hemp, you can, I'd like to see medical and industrial hemp come to Kirksville instead of cannabis. And there's so many things that's been made by hemp. Certainly been hemp from looking at all things, carbon, table, lights, everything. It's made by hemp. And you might have seen online, there's even houses built by hemp. But do you ever see that with campus do that?
No.
But I'd rather see there's so many manufacturing companies out there we can use for the use of hemp instead of cannabis. But I strongly like to see if that happens. But empowering jobs and businesses. And we have one business, so many people turned away from it several years ago. But I'd like to see the business get this town growing with the start of hemp instead of cannabis. I'm very against marijuana and cannabis completely. But I am for medical
and industrial hemp, not cannabis. Thank you. And our last question. What do you believe is the most important economic development issue for Kirksville this year, and how can the city council address that issue? Our first candidate, Stephen Reeser.
I think the biggest issue that Kirksville has is jobs. You know, we're right now, we're developing and putting dollars, into the main street, fixing the downtown, which, is good. You want to have a pleasing image for people when they come into Kirksville. But are we really addressing the underlying problem with this of, making these, shops that are on the downtown a destination? Are we giving the business owners the ability to shop and to be competitive against the big box retailers? The city should be involved in teaching these business owners how to sell. Right now, people will go in, they look at the merchandise that are in the local business. They'll go look on Amazon, they'll look on all the other internet, and then they go and then they shop it that way. We need to teach our local people how to compete against that. Because then, when they sell, they're gonna need additional help. With the additional help, we're gonna have additional revenue. With additional revenue, we're gonna have additional taxes, and then that will then carry back into helping the infrastructure within Kirksville. So really, I think the big thing that we need to work for is really helping our businesses to work in the 21st century. Thank you.
Thomas Smith.
First thing is have respect for everybody else. When somebody gets up there and speaks, you don't sit there and laugh at them because you're for the poor and you're for the ones that's handicapped. You don't laugh at a person like that. You just that ain't respectful. I don't care who it is. You got to be for the people that's out there, not you. And if they can do that, they probably build up on what they have now. But the way I see it, they ain't got no hope. Because they ain't gonna change up there unless they get somebody in there to do it. And I'm talking about the city council. Now, there's two here, it's already in the city council. And they just don't have respect for the public. I think it'd be better if somebody gets in there and does. Thank you.
Again, a reminder to please refrain from personal attacks. Thank you. Daniel Jordan.
Hello again. Question asked, most important economic development issue for Kirksville this year. We've seen an influx of businesses come into Kirksville over the last several years. This year specifically, Hobby Lobby, Shoe Sensation, we've got Gordman's. What I'd like to see is that we build with care. I think we are all too eager as a society in general to see new businesses come in. I'd like to see businesses come in that have a game plan for their staff, for employees, full-time employment, benefits. I want these issues addressed, if not more than as much as where they're going to build and how they're going to build. I think several, excuse me, I think several businesses have come in recently, and they've hired lots and lots of local residents, which is a good thing, only to eventually weed out most people and keep a select few. I want economic development. I've said in the past, I want it to be measured. I'd rather see 10% growth over 10 years than 100% growth in 1 year. Because it would, I think it would be too much for our little town. If we could continue measured growth, I think it would do well for the residents of Kirksville, and again, smaller surrounding communities that use Kirksville as a hub. Thank you.
Jessica Parks.
Thank you, yeah. So it has been an exciting year in terms of business development in Kirksville. One of the things that I think is really important, though, is that, yeah, maybe that we don't grow too fast, we don't get too excited about a lot of the big chain stores that come in, and not to be too dependent upon them. While I do think, like Kraft, there's great jobs and benefits, and they provide so many people in our city with jobs, which are very important. But I would like to see more of an emphasis on taking care of the people of Kirksville, and so maybe that's looking at more like, yeah, making sure they have a plan for long-term stay in Kirksville, because if Kraft would have left in 2015, it would have been devastating for the city of Kirksville and the people of Kirksville. So I think it's really important to look at what's going to take care of the people, and so maybe looking at more development in terms of entrepreneurship, people, investing in people who already live here and call Kirksville their home, new technologies. I do think the idea of industrial hemp is a great industry and idea for Kirksville. We have so much land around us. Of course, one of my passions is downtown improvement. I think when you have a strong, vital, and vibrant downtown, that kind of exudes out into the rest of the city. So if you have a strong heart of downtown, you create a destination where people are excited to go to, that's going to help everyone in the city of Kirksville. So I think it's important to look at more long-term solutions in terms of economic growth and how that impacts the people of Kirksville. Thank you.
Jordan Weichelt.
I believe the most important economic development issue for Kirksville is our roads, to be honest, and our infrastructure. Kirksville's growing. If you look at North Baltimore, how often do you drive in North Baltimore by Arby's, Hobby Lobby, and traffic's backed up, there's no turning lane. I think that needs to be addressed. Adding more sidewalks, how often do you drive in Osteopathy or Baltimore and you swerve around because people are walking on the sidewalk, on the roads, because there's no sidewalks. I think Kirksville's going to keep growing, which is great. I hope it keeps growing. I hope we get more businesses. But if we don't invest in our infrastructure, we're already behind. We're just going to get further and further behind. If businesses come looking to come to Kirksville, they drive down Baltimore. It's kind of embarrassing, and I know ODOT owns it, but to me, that's our biggest economic issue that needs to be addressed. Since this is the last question, I will take this opportunity to thank everyone for being here, and if you have any questions, just let me know. Thank you.
Kevin Ohm.
I know there are a lot of people who are out there and are desperate need for work, and there are people out there who are desperate need for out of work, and sometimes also they're homeless people that are coming to town. And we need to put these people back to work in some way. But I know I have a friend who's working his cook at Woody's. He's been living in front of Walmart for 3 years. Back in K-5 Blazer. And I just want to see how he lives and stuff. And I'm glad he's got a job and working being a cook. But anyway, I've seen a lot of homeless people coming and going in town. I'd like to see and help them, put them to work and provide them shelters, and also funding so they can use to live their life. But anyway, if we can get these issues on their way, the word will pass on quicker than fire. But that will attract the businesses elsewhere, and when these things going the right way. I'm going to sidetrack here a little bit. But anyway, if we can do this in the same way we're supposed to be, but we can attract visitors that often come to town, but we can do it when there's so much things I can say more, but I can't. I'm running out of time. Thank you.
Zach Burden.
Just today I had the opportunity to attend K-Ready's annual meeting, and they were talking about economic development in our area. And the speaker that they brought in works as a site selector. He is a company that his firm sits down and works with industrial firms that are looking to relocate, and what are the things that are important in that matter. When we're talking about economic development and economic and the jobs that fuel that, one of the things he recommended was to work on the things that you have control over. There are things in our community that we have no control over, but there are things that we have a lot of control over. And I asked, can you give me some examples of those? And what I think is nice is it's the things that we've already valued a lot in our community, and end up being the things that aren't just about attracting new industrial and commercial jobs or people to fill the existing positions we have here. It's about the kind of things that improve the quality of life for all of us. It's making sure that we have a road system that functions for everyone that we can be proud of. It's about partnering with MoDOT to continue to look at and keeping our fingers crossed on some announcements in July about where that will be headed, and looking at Baltimore Street. It's about looking at our parks and recreation system and making sure that that's a system that serves everyone, that has a lot of different needs through it, that adequately supports hiking and biking and trails and working with our other offerings that we have in that system. It's about partnering with other agencies in our community. It's about partnering to make sure we have a school system that matters, continues to be something that we're proud of. These are the economic factors that businesses look at when they're deciding whether or not to relocate their own families here. These are the things when we're recruiting positions that are already in our community that people want to be able to see. And they're the kind of things that we'd all like to have more in our community as well. So when it comes to economic development, looking at the things that make our lives more livable and more enjoyable are the things that are going to help us with economic development as well. Something I've always believed in. Thank you.
Chuck Long.
Just adding to what Zach said, 900 jobs is what we brought the town with Kraft. And more than that came with all the other businesses that came in after Kraft. So economic development, I don't see we're having a problem. I think the city staff, K-Ready, city manager, assistant city manager, city council, they've all been doing a great job pushing for new businesses and doing our very best to help them get here and make sure they stay here. Right now, realtors are having a hard time finding houses to sell, which is a good thing, I guess, for us, but not necessarily for the realtors, but rental houses, contractors are going crazy, they're building every day. So I think that right now, economic development is 100% going forward, so, and I'm proud of everybody, so thank you very much.
That concludes tonight's event. Thank you to our candidates. How about a round of applause for all the candidates? Please remember to vote on April 2nd and have a good night.